little bit about jQuery. But first I want to talk a little bit about responsive web design. And you probably got a bit of that in CISS 216, depending on when you took it. But I do want to mention it because it's important. It's an important consideration because so many people browse the web on their phone now compared to computers, whether they be laptops or desktops, plus they use tablets and so on and so forth. So because of that, a big consideration of all your web pages is having them work across different platforms. I mean, that's always been a consideration, but now the platforms are very much varied. There's big differences between someone browsing on a phone and browsing on a computer. So the idea of responsive web design is the idea to make your page sort of respond to where it's being viewed. So depending on where it's being viewed, the page will respond and look a little bit different. Now, it's sort of a big word, all right, responsive web design, but really it's some very basic principles. So let's take a look at those principles, and you should use these principles as you develop pages in this class, and as you develop pages wherever you develop pages. I certainly don't see this trend having any sort of reversal at all. I mean, people are going to have computers, people are going to have phones, and they're going to be using them for different things, but the one thing that they're going to use them in common for is visiting web pages. So that, as long as I can see in the future, that's going to be the case. All right. So therefore, these responsive web design concepts are important. All right. How do I close this? Oh. They're going to do them in this order. I'm going to do them in a different order. I'm going to start with two and we'll come back to one. Two is fluid grids. All right? And that's sort of a big word for saying the elements that you make on your page, instead of having them being an absolute size, make them a percentage. All right? So, in other words, if you have four columns, instead of specifying 200 pixels wide, specify them as being, 20% of the page. All right? If you do that along with floating, that will allow your page to rearrange itself no matter what the circumstances are. So let's take a look at an example of that. Let's go and let's make one real quick. Responsive.html. And I'm going to just put some very basic tags on here just to illustrate some things. So I'm just going to put some blocks on here. I'm not even going to put any content in here, at least not right now. I'm going to put a few sections on this page. Put six sections on my page, and then I'll give each section a size. Start out hard coding those, which we're going to end up changing eventually. And I'll give these a background color of blue. So if we were to view this in our browser, this is what we get. This is what we get. We get a grid. Alright? Grids are big in graphic design. You know, in newspapers and magazines and advertisements. Grids have always been sort of a popular element for storing stuff. And so they talk about fluid grids here. You know, that's something that's a challenge that designers never had to face before, because you know, when you design a magazine, the magazine's a certain size, and everyone's magazine's a certain size. So you can make a grid sort of constant, fixed. With this though, this is a fixed grid on a web page. Now notice the problem with this, if we can imagine being on a smaller device, I didn't use floating with this, if I use another kind of positioning for it, as I made the page smaller, these would stay the same size. Alright? Let's do it with, let's put a header on here to illustrate that point. actually, let's rewind. Let's forget the floating for a second. And let's make all of these a certain size. There we go. That's what I wanted to do. Now, if we look at this, that's what we get. All right. Now, notice that as we make this window smaller or bigger, it cuts off some of the information off to the side. All right. And if you can imagine then, viewing on a computer versus viewing on a mobile device, depending on how the mobile device is, you're liable to cut off some information on it as it gets smaller. As the screen gets smaller, you're cutting information off of it. Responsive also deals with even people that have different size windows on their desktop machine. So how do you get around that? Well, you can get around that by floating and giving percentages. So I can say the width of this is 100%, and the width of these is maybe 20%. And I can float all these to the left. Now this has the advantage of, on a bigger screen, showing more of them on a smaller screen, making the column smaller, because it's a percentage and not an absolute amount. So as I go to a mobile device, those columns will become smaller. I can also give a minimum width to them. So maybe I don't want them to get any smaller than 150 pixels. So at a larger size, a certain size, it will go, but it won't get any smaller than the 150 and width. As I resize the page, they'll get smaller, but they won't go any smaller than a certain minimum width. 150 pixels. Again, as you notice, the page now is conforming to the size of the browser window that it finds itself in. So what's the key to this? Using percentages and floating instead of using fixed positions and fixed sizes. That's the first principle of this. That also applies to images as well. So let's find one of the window sample images, if there is one. Let's go get those zoo pictures that we had last time. Maybe that's in another class. Take this picture. section 1. So I'm going to put in here, image source equals 1.jpg, alt equals pick a lion. Now if I just do this as it is, sort of has that lion and it has all those on top of it. Alright. What I can do instead is I can specify the image to have a width of 100%. Now what does a width of 100% mean? It means 100% of the container. So it will be 100% of the size of the section. So however big the section is, the image will be that big. And as the page gets bigger, the image gets a little bigger, up to a certain point because I put a minimum width in it. All right. So what have we done so far to summarize? I know I got off to a little bit of a rocky start here. We've made percentages the widths instead of some absolute number. We're floating elements. And the idea of floating is, if you can imagine, if this was the first part of the article, the second part of the article, the third part, the fourth part, the fifth part, the sixth part, on a wide screen, you'd have neat little columns here. As the screen got narrower, though, instead of having a multiple column page, you'd have a single column page. All right? In other words, the page will have shaped itself depending on the size of the screen. All right? And that's good. That's a positive. Those are two of the principles of responsive design. The third principle, the one that we put up back up at the top, is we can put different things if the we can put different style sheet rules depending on certain conditions. So I'm going to put this here. I'm going to change it around a little bit. What happens here. Notice that, in fact, let me change the color so we don't get confused with the header. We have a page. At this size, notice the appearance. Yellow header, blue sections. As I get smaller, notice what I got. I got yellow header, red sections. And I just put the colors because hopefully none of you are colorblind and those are obvious to see. All right. How did I accomplish this sorcery? All right. I did it with media queries. this little disclaimer here says if the page is smaller than 400 pixels, then use this style rule for section. So this applies for all sections. Then this is for any of the screens that are less than 400 pixels. All right. So if it's bigger than 400 pixels, I get this rule, the screen. If the screen is bigger than 400 pixels, I get this rule. I get the width of being 20%. I get the background color blue. Those are the two most relevant changes. If the screen is smaller than 400 pixels, though, then the width becomes 100% and the background color becomes red. So you can put media queries on individual style rules, or you can put media queries on entire style sheets. And there's an example on how you do that. In fact, a good approach to take is what's called mobile first, where you design two style sheets. One which contains the base that everyone's going to see, whether they're on a mobile device or a desktop device. Then you have a second style sheet that comes into play if they're on a desktop device. And what that does is that adds the features like the columns and different sizes and things like that that you want to have on the desktop version of the site. So you have a base style sheet, and then you have an enhancement. And then you put a media query on the second style sheet, so it applies only in the case of whether of it being a desktop machine. All right? And here's an example of that. This is the example we use in CISS 216, so some of you might have seen it before, but still it's worth taking a look. Over the progressive enhancement. I'm not looking at the graceful degradation. Well, we could look at it. I lied. Progressive enhancement works like this. We have a page that has two style sheets in it. If we do a view source, we have a base style sheet and a desktop style sheet. Everyone gets the base style sheet. If you meet these criteria, then you get the desktop style sheet. So if your minimum device width is 601 pixels, in other words, if the 600 pixels are bad or bigger, then you get the style rule too. Alright? So, on a browser, a desktop browser, this is what you see. If we were going to go to a mobile device, that's what you see. Alright? Same web page, same style sheets, except because the way that we've written this, there are two style sheets, one of which applies all the time, one of which applies only for a desktop. So, when we're viewing this in the mobile emulator, we only get this style sheet, which is a very plain style sheet. If we're viewing it on a desktop browser, whereas the minimum width is 600 pixels or bigger, then we get this desktop style sheet, and that's what makes it fancier, by putting it in several columns and giving a background image, etc. So with this mobile first, or progressive enhancement, you start out with your baseline mobile, plain looking web page. And then you add a second style sheet to add sort of the enhancements that you're going to put in based on the fact that you have a bigger screen to work with. Graceful degradation is the opposite. Graceful degradation, you start with the full-blown website. Again, this is similar but not exactly the same as the other one. And then you go in and you change things based on. So notice this one has a picture, this one doesn't have a picture. No picture there. Mobile first or progressive enhancement starts with a plain website and then adds stuff to it for a desktop. Graceful degradation does the opposite. You start with the full-blown website and then you take away stuff in the mobile version. Which approach should you use? If you're starting from scratch, mobile first is a better approach to take. So if you're starting and developing a brand new website, it's better to take the mobile first approach. Design the simple, straightforward mobile site and then go add additional stuff in for a desktop site. If you're doing the reverse, if someone already has a website that works well in the desktop browser but just needs to be altered to work in a mobile environment, then you want to do the graceful degradation. You already have style sheets that work on a desktop. You just want to write additional style sheets to trim away some of the content and some of the frills if it's going to be displayed in a mobile device. And again, the way that you differentiate between these two is with mobile queries. Media queries. Media queries are what allow you to apply different style sheets in under different conditions. So, our three guidelines for responsive design. Make your grids floating grids. You do that by using percentages. By using the float property, make your images relative. You do that by, again, using percentages. So we're not going to be using pixels for size. We're going to be using percentages for size. And then finally, using media queries to allow different styling if the device is a mobile device versus if the device is a desktop device. Those are the three characteristics of responsive web design. All right. Now on to jQuery. If we could imagine, gotta keep all my examples here. I'm gonna create a new one. Let's imagine we have an assignment similar to what we have done before. That is, you had to create a, that's what a JPEG looks like if you added it. Say we had something like this. We had three sections that have a little bit of content. That's something that you did for your first assignment, and then you refined it in your second assignment, and so on. So let's say we have this page. Responsive page by saving as. No, I didn't. It's just called accordion now. I'll have to remember to rename it before I post it. Because this is going to become accordion and that's going to become responsive. Oh, I'm really confused now. I'll sort this out. Hopefully I still have everything. Okay. So now this is called responsive 2. And I have that. Now, we did an example like this where we had tabs, right, going along the top. And as you clicked it, it showed the one and hid the others. Another way to do this is what's called an accordion control. An accordion control is where one's visible. If you click on the heading, that one shows and the other two hide. All right? So let's implement that real quick in JavaScript. That should be fairly easy to do. All right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hide the other two. So I'm going to say pound sign S1, pound sign S2. I'm going to just say display none. Then we'll put on these guys on click equals display S1. It's probably very similar to what you did with the tabs. I think we're going to need quotes around these. You know, we didn't have any snow days this semester. I think the president ought to be able to declare that we have a good weather day and cancel classes because it's too nice. One of you guys should go to the next time that there's like a presidential forum and suggest that.
It's a good idea.
It's a very good idea. I am full of great ideas. All right. So what am I going to do now? I'm going to create a function in JavaScript if I can type. That says display function display. Accepts an argument. And does what? It's going to say, I'm going to hide all the other ones. Document get element by ID. S1 style display column first, and I'm going to display the one that I want. This should be very similar to the tab example that you guys did. The only difference is the visual is going to be different. And we should be able to see in a minute how it's different. Oh, it should be S2 and S3. There I go. Now I click on this, and topic 1 disappeared, and topic 2 displayed. Click on that, topic 3 appears, and topic 2 displays. Let me go in and put a 1, 2, and 3, so we're making sure that we're seeing the right content. So we got that. Blah, 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 1 is showing. We click on topic 2, blah, 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 2 is showing. Blah, 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 3 is showing. All right, so this would be a different way to organize your page that you did in that early example. Now, this wasn't hard to do, right? But this is something that you could imagine doing a lot of times on a web page. You could imagine if you were going to use this sort of, what would you call it, navigation or sort of display scheme, that you might want to do this in a lot of different places. And it's nice whenever you have a task that you might want to do in a lot of different places if there's an easy, quick, and dirty way to do it. And that's what jQuery provides for you. jQuery is nothing but a framework that's built in JavaScript that allows you to do JavaScript more quickly. All right? Allows you to do JavaScript more quickly by giving you some shortcuts, by giving you some built-in functions that just simplifies things. So let's look at a jQuery example here. That accomplishes an accordion control. Thing. They do some nice things. They, for example, make the active section blue, all right? And they make they have a little icon that indicates whether it's expanded or not. Notice that little triangle points down, that indicates that it's expanded. Here are the little triangles pointing to the title, which indicates that it's compressed. And so as I go and click on this, boom, it does the same thing. It actually does it cooler, right? Because you get almost a little animation going on here. Notice as I click that, it's not like, boom, it appears, but slides up. All right, which is kind of a neat effect. All right, lets the user clearly see what's going on. So, functionally, this does a little better than what I had done, and it's going to be easier to do. So let's look at the source for this. Let me copy this. So here's my local copy of this. There we go. And as we click on these things, we get that. I'm probably missing a CSS file. That's not why. I'm probably display. We can look at the source and do that. Let's see how this is accomplished, though. First of all, notice that they have a couple. Yeah, they have a CSS file in here that we're missing. So that's why ours looks a little different. But notice they have this is a style sheet that they created, but they have three things from the jQuery set. They have a base for jQuery UI. They have a style sheet for jQuery.ui. They have and then they have two scripts that come from jQuery. One is a jQuery sort of the base package. The other handles UI elements. So you need both of these to make this effect work. So, the bottom line is they're getting two things from jQuery. They are getting the style sheet to style some of the jQuery elements, and they are getting two scripts. One for just basic jQuery stuff, the other for jQuery UI stuff. Now, here is the code that does it. Wow, it's almost like, why did you teach us this the first day? Why did you put us through all that pain and agony to learn JavaScript? Well, I think it's good to learn JavaScript and understand how it works. All right? But this does it all for you. So if you were doing this, you really don't need to do a lot of your own work. All right? You simply define that. And let's dissect this to see if we understand it. What this is saying is that, what do you think this is? What do you think that's the equivalent of?
Look for the ID accordion.
Yeah, look for the ID accordion. All right, so this is sort of a shortcut for the get element by ID. All right?
Is that the money sign?
That's what it's the dollar sign, money sign, yeah. And then we're going to add an accordion function to it. We're going to add an accordion function. And the accordion function is something that's defined in this UI. We could look for it if we wanted to. Alright? And all we have to do then is make sure that the right thing has ID in it, and we have our headings defined correctly. Because it uses the headings to make sure that the stuff works. Now notice the advantages of doing it this way. Number one, there's almost no code. Number two, if we added another section to this example, it would still work. All right? Because it's dealing with everything in that accordion div. It's not just dealing with certain things. The example that I wrote, a big drawback of it is that if you added another section, you'd have to add some JavaScript code to handle that. There's other advantages too. This has been tested cross-browser. It's been tested thoroughly where your code probably isn't. All the advantages of dealing with a framework. We have frameworks in so many areas. If you learn ASP.NET, there's frameworks there. jQuery is a sort of a framework for JavaScript, and so on. So we have the advantage of having this code, that we can tap into and use, and all we have to do is make sure that we use the scripts from jQuery. Now, you can do one of two things. You could either download the script to your web server, so I could download these scripts if I wanted to my web server, or you can point to them where they live on the jQuery site. Either one of them is acceptable. All right. Notice what this is doing is this is actually pointing to the URL out on jQuery's site where this script lives. And they allow you to do that. All right. It's not like you're, you know, hacking them by doing that. You know, that's an allowable thing. And the only other thing that we are missing in this case is the style sheet that they wrote. Let me see if I can find that. Yeah, it doesn't have that. Now, we can do things like putting custom icons in. We can do things like allow for scrolling, no automatic height, and we can make it sortable. So these are extra options that we can take in doing the accordion. And again, in doing that, notice that there's just a little bitty bit of code that we add to that. But the basic accordion function is accomplished with this. All right, we'll look over some other things as far as jQuery goes next time. Questions? Yes?
In front of the function, there's a dollar sign.
Yes.
What does that do?
That tells it that it's a jQuery thing.
Oh.
So in other words, it's not looking for a JavaScript function or anything. It's looking for like a jQuery thing.
Okay.
Yeah. So you'll see that a lot anytime. Let's look at any of this code. Yeah, like here, dollar sign, this, accordion. That's telling it to run like a jQuery function.
Okay.
Other questions? All right. I'll go unlock the door. I know a couple people had questions. I will go unlock the door. I'll come back here, sort out all my examples, and upload them, and